And here I'm right back for the second episode of my beginner tutorials talk on the space program. And yeah, maybe I should have in the first one where I showed the facilities, I should also have told that the vehicle assembly building and the space plane hangar are where you build your spacecraft. And then the launch pad, or accordingly the runway, are where you launch them. But I guess it's self-explaining, and if you just clicked at the VAB, you will have figured it out by yourself. So, and yeah, in the last episode we have taken on two contracts, which we will now have to, or which we will now easily can complete in our first episode. So let's go to the VAB, because we don't have parts for space planes, yes? Yeah, yet. Yes, I got it. I will explain it. And so, yeah, here in the VAB you can build your craft, and you have your parts here on the left-hand side. And as I said before, I removed all my mods, partly for stability and performance reasons, but mostly to just make this a bit more organized. And right now, because you have only one tick tree node research, of course it is very organized. You have these categories of pods or command parts, fuel tanks, which currently is empty, engines, where we have only one solid rocket engine, that's the reason we don't have any fuel tanks. Command and control is empty, where you have things like reaction wheels or RCS thrusters, these little thrusters that control the attitude of your spacecraft. Structural, well, we have the modular girder segment. I don't know what we could use it for at the beginning of the game, but we just got it. Robotics you only get when you have the Breaking Ground DLC installed. And well, I never really understood how to use them, so maybe I will find a total rookie tutorial for me. Coupling, which you will need for staging. We will talk about that, I guess, in this episode. And yeah, we will talk about most of the parts later. Payload is empty too. Aerodynamics, we have the basic fin, maybe we will need that. Ground is empty, where we will have landing wheels or landing legs or rover wheels, etc. etc. Thermal, talking about heat shields mostly. Electrical is empty. And communication. I think it's better to talk about each of the categories when they come up instead of now giving a description for an empty box. And science, where we currently have the goo, mystery goo container. Cargo, you will also only have with the Breaking Ground DLC. And utility. So, yeah, I think we will just do this in the, in the schedule that we will need it. So let's just talk about all this stuff when it comes up. And yeah, what do you need for building a rocket? You need to control it, obviously, and we could take the Mark 1 command pod or the KV-1 Onion Vostok pod from the Making History DLC. Or this one actually is a Mercury command pod. So we will take this one because the spherical onion obviously is quite unaerodynamic, and it would need a payload fairing, I think, yeah, payload fairing, which we do not have right now. So yeah, we have our command, and so we need an engine, obviously. Currently we don't have any liquid fuel engines, and so no fuel tanks, and the only one that we will have is this RT-5 Flea. So we can just place it underneath it. And yeah, so we have an engine, but our rocket cannot land. So it will land, but it will leave a little bit of a smoking hole in the ground. So we will take the parachute, which leads us directly to the next thing to keep in mind when building rockets. There's a lot of memes about always check your staging, which right now the staging is this thing here would not work properly. because here you can see a little symbol for the solid rocket motor, and in the same stage you can see the parachute. So if you would press the stage button, which by default is the space, we would ignite our motor and we would deploy the parachute, which of course is stupid because the parachute would slow us down. So what we do is we create a second stage by pressing this little plus button and move the solid motor there. I could also deploy the parachute first, but that would be stupid. So yeah, and this little blue number here is the delta V, but currently we don't really need to care about that one. So let's talk about that later. So yeah, we have our rocket, it will launch and it will deploy the parachute. And so we have this contract which requires us to gather some scientific data, and even if we would not have this contract, it would make sense because otherwise we couldn't progress in the tech tree. So we can add the only experiment that we currently have and yeah, just put it somewhere. Let's do it here. And what we now have is at least theoretically our rocket would be more heavy on that side than it is on that side. So let's see if there's a way to simulate more weight on that side. But I think there are no more radially attachable parts. So anyway, because in the first episode I talked about people trying to build shuttles and they will just spin out of control, because what you have to do is align your center of mass, the yellow and black thing like you can see in crash test dummies, with your center of thrust, which is this thing here, and you can also see the vector of your thrust. And if you now like had your center of mass shifted to there and then the center of thrust there, you would have basically a lever which then starts to spin your rocket out of control. I guess I can demonstrate that if we have more parts available. So yeah, and you can toggle the different center of mass, center of thrust, and aerodynamic overlay. You can toggle it on here. The aerodynamics we will also talk about later. So what you do is you place your parts, in that case the mystery goo containments, in a symmetrical way, like this. And I guess I even did it quite nice. But what makes this thing easier is toggle the symmetrical attachment. That's the word I was looking for. What you can do here, you can set the different symmetries: double, triple, 4 times, 6 times, 8 times. And with R you can also change from radial to mirrored symmetry, but that also that one we will talk about later. So yeah, we just take this mystery goo container and we magically have a second one because it was arranged in a symmetrical way. And I guess that this would complete our very first launch. So we can take a look. Jebediah Kerman will be the pilot by default, and we can just go to the launch pad. So here we are, and we can already take the first science report, which you do by right-clicking your science part, and then there it is, observe Mr. Rigu. It reads, the goo doesn't seem to be doing much right now. It's also this kind of Kirby style that I really like, that the science is about mysterious goo and what it does, or the whether or not the surface of Minmus is edible. And like I also already said, I like to play with mods, and I really prefer this Kerbal style mods instead of the more serious and more realistic ones. So yeah, here's the first lesson in flying. And I think a very common mistake for beginners also is forgetting about SAS, or the stability assist system, or sickness avoiding system, which you can toggle by default with the button T, or I think you can also, yeah, by clicking that one. And what this does is, if you have a pilot on board, we will only talk about manned space flight. I will do a second episode on another episode on probes. And if you have a pilot on board, that pilot can hold your craft stable if he's a level zero pilot. And if he's more experienced, he can also point the vessel in some specific directions. But again, that's stuff for a future episode. So anyway, we are on the launch pad. Our pilot is doing a Jebediah Kerman, is holding our rocket stable. And yeah, I guess there's nothing left. We can hit space and go flying. While we are flying, we can observe the other Mr. Rigu. And if you now take a look, we will get 7 science if we recover it, or 2.9 science if we transmit, but we don't have an antenna. And of course, we will land maybe even on the launch pad. If you now take a look at the other one, you can see that we will only get 3 science points for recovering it, because the amount of science depends on the situation you are in. So you would get even more science in the high atmosphere, and even more in space, and so on and so forth. So yeah, we are still going up now, passing 1,300 meters. No, 13,000. And here you can see at the variometer that we are now starting to fall. And once we are falling, we can deploy our parachute. The parachute currently is only semi-deployed, because I have set, or I didn't set anything. It is set to default to deploy the parachute 1,000 meters above the ground. And you could also, with the pressure, you can change the atmospheric pressure at which the parachute will partially deploy, like this. But if we would have increased the atmospheric pressure, and this very simple rocket would have been falling too fast until it reached this set pressure, and the parachute could not deploy anymore, leading to a crash. So yeah, we could just set the altimeter here to the altitude or the height above ground, and once it hits 1,000 meters, the parachute will deploy. And there it goes, and landing, still landing on the launch pad. So, anything else I wanted to say about the first flight? But I think not. So yeah, successful flight, I would say. And we can press this green button here to recover. So here we can see that we earned 15 science points from the two Mr. Rigu experiments, and for recovering a vessel that survived the flight, which maybe by Kerbal standards already is quite a nice achievement. But this recovery science points you will only get for doing something the first time, and the second, and maybe a third, but it is constantly decreasing. So yeah, we got 15 science points and altogether have 25 because we also got, or here we have the funds that we get back. And we will get back the, I think, the full price because we landed on the launch pad, and on the launch pad and on the runway you will get the whole price of your crafts refunded. Minus the fuel, of course, that we have burned in the flight. So yeah, Jebediah Kerman is back. He gained one experience point, but that still doesn't give him or doesn't let him advance one level. But that one, or about the not talking about, but you can see the first advance in Kerbal level when we will have the first Kerbal in orbit. So yeah, we are done. And as you see, we got 15 science points from this flight, but right now we have 25. Because from the world first milestones, we also got some science and reputation points and funds from some things like breaking speed records, breaking altitude records. And we also have this contracts. We have completed the contracts that we taken in the that we have taken in the first episode. So yeah, we have 25 science points. We have 4 times as much funds as in the beginning, and can now head into the research and development department and already do some research into the basic rocketry, where we get a liquid fuel tank, so I can show the offset center of Mars. Can take the engineering 101, which we will also need, and still have 15 science points left, which will take us to survivability. So yeah, that way we can build the second vessel for this episode, where I will show staging. And yeah, let's just remove this one, and we got a decoupler, which is what I said before, it's useful for separating two parts. So if I was now to activate this decoupler, this solid rocket motor would get disposed or would just get jettisoned, and we will be left with the command pod. And in the staging right now, we have the decoupler and the solid rocket motor in one stage. So if you press the stage button, we would activate the solid rocket motor. I don't even know why I always am searching for the world. And we would toss it away immediately, which again is stupid. So we can move the decoupler to stage 0. And now have the solid rocket motor in the first stage, and then in the second stage we will decouple it and deploy the parachutes for landing. So we can now increase the minimum pressure to 0.75 atmosphere. So the parachute will partially deploy at about 1500 meters, and then at 1000 meters it will fully deploy, so the landing is quicker. And yeah, but from the added weight from the decoupler, we will not fly as high as in the first flight. So we can add a second decoupler and the larger solid rocket motor that we recently researched. So we can simplify the staging by just staging the decoupler and the small solid rocket motor in one at once. So we will have the large motor, and once it's burnt out, we will jettison it and activate the small one. And then in the last stage, we will also jettison the small one and deploy the parachute, or activate the parachute. So, yeah, because now I just did it because it is standard for me, because maybe someone who is new will try to somehow botch the solid rocket motors together without decouplers or something, but basically that's the way to do, because now once the motor is burnt out, it is only that weight, it doesn't do anything, so let's get rid of it and activate the second one. And previously I was talking about the offset center of mass, which I could now demonstrate with this liquid fuel tank. So again, we could show the center of thrust and the center of mass. If I now attach this liquid fuel tank here, or maybe add a second one. So you can, tanks are radially attachable and by nodes. And if you press Alt, you will only attach them by nodes. So now you can really see how this thing will spin like crazy. So let's remove that rubbish. And let's also add some fins to this long vessel for stability. You will need at least three to have stability on both in both ways. So let's only add three to save weight. And yeah, we also got some new experiments. Barometer. No, barometer is the German way to pronounce it. And a thermometer, which you can place here. And I think, yeah, they are the same weight, so this will still be balanced. And yeah. That's good enough for our second launch, I guess. So let's go to the launch pad. So here we are, double check the staging. Yeah, looks good. Hit SAS and go. Yeah, let's go a bit eastward by pressing D, which is, well, I'm used to it, and in the next episode, where we will talk about more staging and Delta V, and finally we'll reach Kerbin orbit. I could explain that. So the first stage is burned out, and the second one, going faster and faster, already reaching space. Also jettison the first one to reduce weight at the same drag, and yeah, don't fly that high, because if you look at that, yeah, will be steep re-entry into the atmosphere. We're currently in the high atmosphere, so we observe our mystery goo. We'll get 9 science for it. What does it say? Yeah. The goo seems to be getting cold. Let's take a look at the temperature. Oh. Yeah. So anyway, we are in space at an altitude above 70 kilometers. But if you see here, we will fall right back. So we didn't achieve orbit. This is a suborbital space flight, and orbit we will do in the next episode. But what we get here is even more science points. Now it's 10. We can also log the pressure data. The instrument reads nothing because it's in a vacuum. And I guess the temperature is hard to read. Oh no. Because usually one of the temperature scans that you might get in space is that it is quite hard to read the temperature because you're in a vacuum, and it is hard to read the temperature of a vacuum. So we are still going up. And yeah, we can hit time warp, which you do either way by pressing the buttons up there or pressing point and comma. For re-entry, I recommend to go retrograde. Sorry, I have a really strong German accent. Retrograde is backwards, and this is the, you can see two yellow yellow marks here. The other one for prograde is turned 180 degrees, and the yellow mark with three lines at the side, forming. Oh, that's typical Kerbal Space Program. Typical. And yeah, with the three crosshairs at the side is for retrograde, for going backwards. Shit, I should have taken the escape the atmosphere contract. Would have gotten some money now, some funds. Never mind. The future episodes I won't do in career mode anyway, because it is a bit of a pain to grind until you to grind the tech tree until you have the parts to reach orbit. In or it is possible, but in a or it is possible quite quickly in a very botched way. But I like to do things properly. There's the small island airfield, by the way, which is very useful as sort of backup or emergency landing strips if you have to abort a shuttle launch or a space plane launch, or if you overshoot the runway, you still can land there. So we are. Ah, it is even at 1800 meters that the parachute will partially deploy, and below 1000 meters it deploys fully. And here we are. Nearing splashdown. And let's not look at that glitch over there. And yeah, just to rehearse, when building a rocket, you have to look at your center of mass and center of thrust. They have to align. And yeah, check your staging here. Or at least to begin with, you have to stage and you have to check your staging, and then it's not that hard. And especially some basic rockets like that one, piece of cake. And Jebediah Kerman, the first Kerbal in space, has landed again. But he didn't stay long in space because it was only a suborbital flight and no real orbit. So let's recover. But we are still quite close to the KSC, so it will be near to the price that we paid in the beginning. So anyway, we got 47 science points. And let's see. Yeah, I think in the first launch, where we got 100% refunds, we got 588 funds for the command pod. Now it's 565, so it's still nearly the full price. And that's interesting. I thought that if for reaching space, Jebediah Kerman would also gain one experience point, but he didn't. So anyway, we now got 56 science points to play with. And yeah, that one we will need. I will show why. And that one we will need. We still got 18 science points left, but that's not enough for the remaining ones. So for the third, and I don't even know if I will launch it. So yeah, there was one thing that I wanted to show. Yes, exactly. If the center of thrust is or the center of thrust, and then there's the direction of thrust. So if we now attach the engine and turn it a little, which you can do with this tool. You have this tool is up there where you can move a part like this. Let's revert, and you can turn it like this. And if we now keep it that way, the third one is to reroute this fucking accent of mine. So, yeah, because Kerbal Space Program, basically, you have this the command pod here, and then every part is attached to that command pod in some way. So you have the decoupler attached to it, and then the engine, etc., etc. And by rerouting, you can change that. Like, we can take that one, and now this one is our root part, and the command pod is attached to it. But reverse that one. So if we now look at our center of thrust, we can see that the vector is a bit turned to the side. It's offset. It's not all the way offset like the engine is, because it currently counts in all three engines. And so if we now also take a look at the center of mass again, it will turn. It will just spin around. We can try to... Yeah. Now the center of thrust, or the thrust vector, nearly goes through the center of mass. And if it did, our rocket would move sideways at liftoff, which is yet another problem with building shuttles. So, I wanted to talk a little bit more about staging, because you can also add the you can add boosters to the side of your rocket. This is the radial decoupler, which basically does the same thing like this decouplers, but it will blast off the parts to the side and not just toss them down. So we can add an engine to it. And yeah, but I think you already got what I was saying about center of mass, center of thrust, and you can see nothing fits. This thing once again will spin like crazy, so you always have to add your boosters in a symmetric way like this. And also a common mistake with this decouplers is to not to attach the boosters to the decouplers like this. So if you now take a look, there's the decoupler, but the motor is not attached to it. Instead, it's attached to the motor here in the middle. So you have to to be a bit, how to say, precise. So if you now look, the motor is attached to the decoupler. And yeah, with this small motors, you have to be real clumsy to not attach them to the decouplers. But with a bigger one, if you just slap it somewhere, you could see it happened. And also with bigger motors, you might have the problem of them a bit flipping around and being loose on the decoupler, and then your whole rocket starting to roll mostly. So you have to add the struts, the space tape, but we don't have it yet. So anyway, I think that concludes the second episode of my beginner tutorial, and where we talked about things like staging and balancing your rocket and some science. And in the next episode, we will send a Kerbal, or a rocket with a Kerbal inside, into orbit. And again, if you enjoyed it, I appreciate if you leave a like and check out this channel and my main channel. And if you like it, leave a subscribe to them. And yeah, also comment if you like it, if you have some improvements. I'm pretty sure I still have to improve my speaking, because I'm not used to speaking without without audience. Well, of course I have audience, but on the internet, and it's unusual to me. I even refuse to, well, I'm reluctant to speak to phone answering machines. But yeah, I appreciate some feedback, and I'm also considering to make some videos with a complete career save, because I want to start a new one once again. And yeah, just tell me about how you like my video, and as I said, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.